The flesh is weak. Wax is forever.
I'm Steph.
And I'm Ange.
We're Nerdazons.
The flesh is weak. Wax is forever. This is so good. Love it.
I know. How good is it? All right. So this fortnight is my choice, and I thought, why not do something spooky? And I'm choosing the 1953 House of Wax versus the 2005. So we will start with the synopsis. 1953. An associate burns down a wax museum with the owner inside, but he survives only to become vengeful and murderous. And the 2005, a group of teens are unwittingly stranded near a strange wax museum and soon must fight to survive and keep from becoming the next exhibit.
Ooh. I'm so glad you finally chose to do this one, because you teased us with it like last year.
I did. Okay, what an amazing film the 53 was.
Yeah, I love it.
I remember seeing the 2005 back probably when it came out, because I was all about the teen slasher movies like Scream. I know, yeah, it last summer. It. And same. So who didn't have a crush on Dean from Gilmore Girls?
You didn't have a crush on
Chad Michael Murray?
Yes, I would take him any day. But...
And also because of a Cinderella story with Hilary Duff.
Oh, Hilary, yeah.
Duff, lol.
Which is funny, because didn't she also do a movie with Jared Padalecki? Oh, no, wait, I'm thinking of Tom Welling, Cheaper by the Dozen.
Okay, first of all, I want to go to storyline.
Yes.
First fun fact of the show. That this is actually, the 1953 is actually a remake of a 1932 film called Mystery of the Wax Museum.
Oh, I didn't know that. I actually thought
neither
this was
did
the
I.
first one. So there you go. I had no idea. Maybe I'll have to find
neither
that
did I.
And watch it.
I'm tempted. And I like that we've done classics this Halloween season.
Love it.
But with the storyline, who would have thought to make like wax and then turn this like and get the people like to get the sculptures and think, yep, let's actually use humans?
I really like the story of the 1953, because there's so much more depth to why he did it.
So much tension, and you know, like, I was like, wait, who is that creepy guy? Who is he? And, oh, my gosh, I have to say, though, that Kathy Gray, her laugh was so annoying. And I was like, can you please just laugh?
I forgot when I put it on. So I watched it last year before you decided not to do it. And my partner was sitting in the background. And when I put it back on, and then I heard her laugh again when she was messing with the owner. He dies, and I just remember sitting there thinking, oh my god, I forgot how annoying her voice was. But I really like the depth they have to Vincent Price's character, Professor Henry Jarrett, because it brought a passion to his skill and his artwork. Mm-hmm. So he was a sculptor, and he obviously used the material wax for his sculpting, but then mm-hmm. it just showed how obsessed he became with, you know, his sculptures before he was even gone. So he was already partially mad. And then B, I like that the story and the tragedy that happened at the beginning is what turned him into kind of like that mad scientist, which I feel was so much more evident in classic films, that mad scientist, and him becoming mad to find bodies and do that.
In the old films, I've realized if you have a mustache, you're a creep. You know, you're the bad guy if you have a mustache.
I don't think all the time.
No, but it's funny.
Yeah. Most of the time. Yeah. But
I have another little fun fact. Carolyn Jones, who played Kathy Gray, was actually the original Morticia Adams.
Oh my god, I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
What? I need to see this. I need to see it. Oh my god.
She's and
so different.
Another fun fact, I'm just going to, like, I've got a few, but this was actually the first 3D film.
Yeah, I know. I remember when I watched it and the scene when he's like, step right up, I love those classic type of salesmen to get you in the door. And then when he was like hitting the things at the screen, I'm like, this must have been a 3D film. And then when I went and had a look, I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. So what I really like about this story is it kind of had everything. It had, deception, double cross. It had love story. It had a crazy mad scientist. And I think the story was simple. It was an hour and a half. It made sense. You know, he was nearly killed and it sent him to go crazy, which is why he did what he did. Whereas if we compare the storyline to House of Wax 2005, I really don't see how you could result from their upbringing, the kids' upbringing.
Kids in quotation marks.
The kids, the triplets. I don't see how you can go from that story of, from a wax maker to a whole town full of wax. It just doesn't. It doesn't make sense to me. I get it that they really, I feel like early 2000s had a lot of, how do I put this? Small town horror creepy stories, which yes. I do also really like because I feel like somewhere out there in some small town in some wacko, like, you know, Children of the Corn, Jeepers Creepers, they had all those types of like horror films at that time. Uh-huh. And I think they tried to fit in with the rest of the story. I definitely think the story is jagged compared to the classic. It is a simple story, the line, the classic, but it's smooth in the way it runs, whereas this one's a bit jagged and jumped around.
Well, this one, the 53, you know me, I get bored quite easily, and, you know, but I was intrigued the entire time. I was like, who is this mysterious man? Because it can't be Vincent Price because he's in a wheelchair. And I have to say, though, when he was in the wheelchair and he's like, my hands don't work, and then he was using them to, like, wheel himself around. I'm like, your hands work, bro. But I wasn't expecting the ending. I wasn't expecting him to be that creepy guy. And as soon as he took that mask off and it started to melt, I was like, Angela loved this. Far out, this is her movie.
And you know what, though, what I really like about it, I know I'm jumping into prosthetics here, but they made him look like a disfigured person. They didn't put a little scar like modern movies do now. They actually made him look like a disfigured person.
Oh, speaking of prosthetics really quickly, one of the scenes that really made me want to watch House of Wax 2005 is the bit when they're in the church and Dean is wax is
that's in the house, like that's in the museum at the piano.
And he's like got the tear and you just see that he must be in so much pain, and just seeing that tear as they're trying to like take off the wax, and like that was great.
That I remember watching that when it first came out and I was just like, whoa, that's so cool. And then there's a song I love. So a longtime listener, MJ Macca Jr., actually found this song for me. Anyway, it's from a Japanese band, an 80s band. The way they look kind of reminds you of like Kiss, how they look heavier than what they are. Anyway, the song is about this guy who kills little girls by making them wax dolls. And it's just such a good song, and it's like the song is such a good story in itself that it feels like you're watching The House of Wax. And then I remember watching years ago, one of the first animes I got into was Black Butler, and there was an episode in that as well where the doll maker and his dolls were so good because he would, you know, put wax on little girls and make them into the dolls. And I find it so creepy and it's just so good. I'll have to show you the song after.
Yeah, I got lots to say about the music in the 2005 one. I liked the fact that in the 50s one, it relied on a lot of what's going to happen. You know, with the 2005, it took a good half an hour to actually get it going, and that they over-sexualized each and every character, that I was like, does it need to be like this? Yeah. Does this really need to happen? And like, I just think this is, the 50s is such a good film, and I would definitely watch it again.
Yeah.
I was watching it, and Mum came in, and she's like, is this House of Wax? I'm like, yeah. She goes, this movie, like, scared the pants off me when I was growing up. It's one of the scariest movies I've seen. And, yes, because it had so much build-up, so much tension. And, you know, I like that, like you said, it was simple. I like the fact that, you know, at the end when he revealed who he was, and you were just like, what? What?
Yeah. Just back to what you were saying about how it took a while to get into. So when I watched this film for the first time last year, it did feel longer the first time I watched it because it was all new to me and the music was playing and everything like that. But when I watched it again this time, I realized how quick it jumped into the story. Mm-hmm. Like, the fire happened within 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. He killed the first guy within the first 10 to 15 minutes. So the story moves quite quick. But the first time you watch it, it might not feel like that.
It felt like that for me for the first time. Also, like, having, like, those wax figures looked so realistic.
Yeah.
And that they had such a likeness. And then when he came out and he said to Sue-Ann, would you please pose for me or whatever? And then he brings the head.
Yeah, that's so creepy. And when she's like, not everyone sees your head in a box every day.
What? I guess this is not characters. This is a side bit. But the actual wax people, like when you see the guy that he killed and he's got the, like, he's hanging. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Yeah.
Like, that was so good.
So good. I really love this story. And it just, I think the story definitely wins for the 53 version because it's an actual story. I know they tried to build a story. For the 2005 one, you had the story. There were so many complicated pieces of the teenagers. And then you had, this is where I say it was jagged and disconnected, because then you had the story of learning about the triplets in their own, like, upbringing and why the town was wax. So you had Paris Hilton and her boyfriend, you know, Mum doesn't accept her, but she's pregnant. Then you had the twins weren't getting along with anyone, with each other, because one went to jail or something, lost his scholarship. And then she was also fighting with her partner because she wants to go to New York for a scholarship.
And then you had the other guy who was just there.
Yeah. You
know, there was no point to him.
He was in
scary. And then also, I know, that's why I'm like, where do I know you from, Rory? Where do I know you?
But yeah, also, there's so much to it.
The plot twist at the end of 2005 where they're like, oh, it was actually triplets. You're like, no shit, Sherlock. Like, of course he was in it.
Well, okay, look, I'll admit the first time I watched it, I didn't expect there to be triplets because everything they showed you throughout the film was for twins. And it even showed you the connected twins. They didn't show you anything about a third child. They didn't show
but I thought he was like that. In on it. He had to be in on it.
Yeah, well, yeah, obviously he would have been in on it, but I didn't expect him to be triplets instead of twins, which, again, just kind of ruins the story because the whole point of having, you know, Chad Michael Murray and Elizabeth Cuthbert as twins was there was supposed to be that connection because it was twins against twins.
Did you, like, am I the only one that felt like that those two did not seem like siblings, that there was such romantic tension between those two?
I did not feel that at all.
Oh, yeah, when Elizabeth had her back against the car and he put his hand up against, like, the car, and I was just like, are you two going to make out? Like, you two, I did not get sibling love from them. But also,
I don't remember that scene, and I only watched this like a week ago. That doesn't sound like it to me either. But no, I mean, every time Chad Michael Murray looked at her, he looked pissed. And I'm like, that looks like a pissed off brother.
I got super, like, creepy romancy vibes.
Oh, I didn't get that. You seem to get that from a lot of the shows, though. I don't know.
Is there something wrong with me?
Yeah, I mean, I don't remember that scene, but I definitely remember there was a lot of anger and he was pissed off with her, but I didn't see anything else.
Since we're talking about, like, prosthetics and stuff like that before we move into characters, like I said, the 50s one was amazing. They were so realistic. The whole acting and everything was great. And with 2005... I did like the fact that they, like, where she was like, what is that in the window? I saw somebody. And it was a wax figure of them opening.
Yeah, that was trippy. The first, like, I'm talking back when I first watched this, it was high school, you know. So it was a bit trippy when you first watch it.
But the whole ending of that movie where the whole thing went in flames and the whole
town melted.
Town went up. I was just like, how can you not know that everything is made out of wax to begin with?
Yeah, well, like, it was only, I think it was only the wax museum was physically made out of wax. The other houses in the town, I don't think were made of wax, but they had wax people in them.
Yeah, but like, how could you not know the actual museum wasn't made out of wax? Like, it was just, and then all of that terrible.
But they did know, because remember Jared Padalecki scratched it, and he's like, oh, it's wax museum. It's an actual wax museum.
But like, the whole it going up in flames and then them suddenly like running away and you're like, dude, you would have like collapsed. Like, it was so dumb.
Yeah, I didn't think it was as bad as you're saying it. If anything, it reflects the first film in the first 5 minutes when the wax museum goes up in flames.
It's
the same concept, except it was a physical wax museum, which I thought was pretty cool.
I don't know. I just think CGI was overly used in that, and it was well and truly overdramatic, but it makes sense that they're...
I don't think the CGI was that bad either. I have seen way worse CGI. Some of the films we have done was worse, and they were done at the same time. The CGI, I don't think, was bad. I just think what really ruined the 2005 one was the story, that the story didn't connect with anything. So you couldn't really connect or go on the journey with someone if the story, like, didn't flow.
Yeah,
like the first one worked because first of all, you feel sorry for Vincent Price, right? He's been killed and his artwork has been destroyed. Like, this guy put so much, and you see the love and admiration he has in his own work of what he accomplished.
You know, if they just held on, they could have sold it and made a shit ton of money.
He didn't want to sell it. That was the problem. The other guy did. He wanted to sell. And they couldn't come to an agreement, so then that's why they did
it. Like,
and then you follow the story almost within like 15 minutes. You follow the story of Sue Ellen, and you're like connected to her because she's confused. She saw this monster. She thinks she saw her friend die. Her friend is now in a wax museum, and then you follow the story of her almost dying. Like, it's just so simple and clean. So you're more connected to just that her as a character than you are the multiple people in the 2005 version.
And that's, you know, you walk in and she's like, that looks just like my friend. How did you get the earring? How did you do this? And he's like, because I had a photo of her. And then seeing like the other one that was killed where he was hung, and they all looked so similar that you were like, hold up. Especially if you're thinking about it from the 50s, you're like, hold up. Are they real? Are they not? Where are all these people? I do just to have a few little comments that I made throughout the movie. The first one was that it's so funny that the police and the doctors are like, she probably died like this. She was probably poisoned. She probably, like, okay.
Or when mortician's like, just like a woman to get the last word in when the body moves. And I'm like, oh my God, it's so sexist.
It was not a very feminist-friendly movie. But the other one I've got is when the doctors were like, I thought cars didn't go that fast enough to hurt anyone. Give them time. Yep.
Yeah. 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 Love it. So, should we move on to characters?
Yes. Perfect. So the protagonists, so we'll go Vincent Price. I think antagonist, not the protagonist. They'll come later.
Okay, so Vincent Price, I guess, against the triplets.
Mm-hmm.
That's the easiest way to do it.
Yeah.
First of all, Vincent Price, one man did it way better than three could do.
Heck yes. Yeah. Heck yes.
Yeah.
Although, when you see, this is another comment that I made, in the fact that Paris is right, her and Carly were running around, she's like, what's that smell? And Carly's like, I'm going to go follow the smell. She's like, why would you? Would you make a good, smart decision?
I know. And
seeing all of those bits in the pit, how would you not go, this is creepy AF? let's get out of here.
Yeah, well, they weren't supposed to be there. I think they were supposed to be, like, they were supposed to leave.
Football game.
Yeah, but the car got damaged, so they couldn't really leave.
Okay, these guys in 2005 are dumb. They are so stupid in the fact that Wade and Carly were like, oh, we'll come with you to the car place, and then be like, you are creepy. Can you please, like... duh. Like, of course he's going to be creepy. He already is creepy. Of course he's going to try and, like, do something. When Bo was like, oh, just come up to my house and, oh, we've only got the 16 or the 14 size belts. You'll have to come to my house. I'm like, no, bro.
I don't. Red flag.
Get in the other car. Get in the car with Paris and her boy, Paris and Blake. Yep. And then they can all just go. Like, I'm pretty sure the six of you can fit. If you're squeezing,
I mean, not legally, but I'm sure you could make it work.
Yeah, like, it just irked me so much. And like I said before, the way that they overly sexualized the characters, like, they didn't need that scene of Paige and Blake in the car, and then, you know, she's doing her business.
Yes,
like,
yeah.
Do you need that? Do we need to see that?
That's okay. That's the beauty of horror films from
2000s.
70s, 80s, 90s. It's always about the teen. Like, that's why Scary Movie, Scream had the rules. It's like, anyone who has sex, bang, you're dead in the horror film. Like, there were rules to it. And, like, that's every horror film always has, you know, teens that get drunk, they go party, they have sex, they die. And I don't know. I think because I've seen so many horror films, it didn't bother me as much because that's typically it. Those who are so overly sexually active in a horror film are usually the ones that will die. So
I know, but it's funny to go back from like the 53, like, oh, you're showing your legs.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're showing your legs, you're showing your ankles. Ooh.
But I think for the time that it was made, it was pretty spot on. And I'm pretty sure 2 years prior to that, Freddy vs. Jason came out. It was equally as sexually, like, if anything, you saw so much more. Like, you saw, like, body parts and everything without clothing. So it was much more than what you saw in this. And it was pretty accurate for the time it was released. I wouldn't hold that against it.
No, but it just, I don't know, I just think it was a scene that just didn't need to be seen.
It's, I think, let me try and see if I can sum this up. My taste in classic horror for the good story is finally rubbing off on you, that when you watch a classic, it's so much better than the new stuff because a story will make it. You don't need all that other stuff. You don't need, like, the soundtrack. You don't need the sex scenes. You don't need the partying. You don't need gory, like, deaths because a classic film can just do it.
Yeah, and so I think, as you said, one man versus three, Vincent Price wins. From the moment that he was in that chair and that he was like, I'm paralyzed, blah, 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 just the way that he was talking to Sue Ellen and talking about how beautiful she is and that you'll be my Cleopatra or whoever she was meant to be.
Marie Antoinette.
I was just like, you give me chills. And they're multiplying.
Yeah, he was perfect. But that's why Vincent Price is Vincent Price. He was good in that stuff.
But whereas the other three were just rednecks.
Well, one of them was a real redneck. One was, I don't know, a disfigured good boy that you find out he was the good one eating cereal. And then you just had the one that looked normal but was messed up, which I do like that they did that as a visual representation because, you know, they always say it's the ones that you don't expect that look like it. And he didn't look like he would do that.
No.
You know? And then you see the stars.
Especially when you, like, when you meet him in the church and he's like, there's actually a funeral going on. Like, and I was like, oh, there are people in the town. Oh. That got me, like, I was intrigued with that. I was like, are there people? And then I was just like, oh, no, there's not.
Yeah. Mm. It was good. I liked it.
All right. So let's move on to, Sue Ellen and the Kathy Gray.
Alicia Cuthbert as Carly Jones.
Yes. And also we'll move on to the kids, wink, the teenagers. teenagers. And that's another thing. I was like, are they teenagers? Because, like, Nick, but he looks like a Chad to me anyway, so I'm just going to call him Chad. He was like, yeah, I've been in juvie, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, but you
and
watched
it, this all happened. Yeah, but that's what I mean. Like, they were still in school. She hadn't left for uni yet. He didn't get his scholarship, so he literally did all that before high school was finished.
Yeah, and, like, I didn't care for that, maybe because I'm a bit older now, but I'm like, I didn't care for that bad boy vibe. I was like, been there, done that, seen that, don't care. Whereas...
it was just, there wasn't enough time to develop any of their stories to really connect with them. Even Carly, like, you couldn't really connect with her either. She was the good girl that everyone, like, every guy wanted to be with. And then the jealous boyfriend, Wade, and then they had a fight.
He was too nice.
Study, and it's just... it just didn't work as well as you thought. And then they wanted her to be tough at the same time. And it's like, no, didn't work. Hit and a miss.
And then, you know, when everything happened and then, like, Carly and Nick or Chad were in the ambulance and they were like, you've got this, you've got this. Like, you're not going to be distraught. Although, when Paige dies, Paris, wow, I was like, this is a sick kill.
I remember when that first happened, before I'd seen the film, I just remember people in the grades laughing, saying, ha ha, she dies what she does best.
Yeah.
In real life. And then when I saw, it's just weird to me now to think back at how immature we were when we watched these films, because we were in high school. And then to be like,
Then, like, Dalton, what was he for? Just to be the first beheading?
He was a peculiar, like, he was the odd character. He didn't need to be there. He didn't add anything to it. Yeah, I think the story could have progressed without him at all. But I will have to say, I know I'm going to jump a little bit here. I really liked how creative they got with filming the wax process. So in the 1953 one, I guess they used the drip method. So
yeah.
I guess if you're same with icing on a cake, you want to drip the cake in and then just like have it set. So that was his plan, was to have her lay flat and then put her in a massive vat of wax. Whereas in this one, the guy got so creative. He had, and it makes sense to me even just sitting here thinking, he had like rods and everything to put you in place to how he wanted. He knew he wanted him to sit at the piano and he had him all like wedged and in his thing and then tightened all the bolts and then poured the wax on him. And I thought that was a really cool addition.
That was great. I did like that effect. Whereas, you know, I also want to talk about Kathy Gray. I think she was meant to also be the comic relief. Because she was always, you know, making jokes and laughing around, but her laugh, man.
It's so funny because when I watched it, it reminded me, it's like the same two, how do I put it? The same two templates for best friends in that time. When you think of Dracula, even if you think of, if you've seen the Bram Stoker's one with Winona Ryder and that, like Mina is always the quiet person having to work really hard, having to work for a girl of that time. And then you had the crazy outgoing friend who was all over the guys, wanted the attention, didn't want to do anything. And that's the exact same thing that they did with this.
And also with the 2005 as well.
Are they the only Harrison, two types of, you know, girls you could have in a film?
Clichés.
The smart one that does nothing and then the overly sexually active one. The same happened in Freddy vs. Jason, now that I think about it. And in the original Nightmare on Elm Street, it's literally the two same thing. There's always but then we know whoever's more active is the one that dies.
Yep. I still haven't seen the Scream, the last one yet.
I haven't either. Really good. Yeah, I do have to watch it. I haven't watched it either.
Like, maybe this is a product of its time, but when Sue Ellen was in the cop shop and, you know, she's like, you're overreacting, and when Lieutenant Tom Brennan finally is like, hey, something's going on, you know, and when he's like on the phone, quick, we need this, and, you know, okay, don't believe the woman, it's fine.
Yeah, I know, I know. It's hard to think, is it a product of its time for the 50s, or were they trying to replicate what it would have been like for them in the 1800s?
Yeah, I reckon this was set, you know, in the turn of the century.
Yeah.
Well, considering all the horses.
And the cars.
Oh my gosh, what a gorgeous set design.
Yeah, it was really cool. I really liked it. It was simple. Love it.
I thought set design wise, the 2005 wasn't, it just looked like some
backwater town, like redneck town.
Yeah. Yeah, and, you know, once you realize that nobody was in the town, you're like, oh, okay, I know what's happening now. Kind of, it got very predictable. The 53 one was unpredictable. I was just like, what? Like I said, I didn't know who that creepy guy was. And, you know, especially when they showed Sue Ellen's head, you were like, oh, are they real? Are they just gone and been murdered and they've, you know, mystery or disappeared? Or are they really wax?
Yeah. Yeah.
And, yeah, I really liked the 50s. And I'm so glad I watched it.
I'm so glad you did too.
One of the last things I want to talk about is how good the 2005 music was. This was like my...
As soon as I heard it, I was like, oh god, I love this about that type. Like,
because it's got, you know, System of a Down, My Chemical Romance, The Stooges. I was just like, heck yeah. Oh my god, and I'm looking at the playlist now going, Evanescence, oh yeah. And like, I've actually like been listening to it going, this is bringing back so many memories.
I know, so even cool. When I watched it, I was just like, oh yeah, this was everything I listened to.
This is 2005 hardcore music. But what do you rate The House of Wax 53?
This is a film I've seen a few times now, and I will watch it again. So I'm going to go... I'm going to go 4.5. I think it's really good. I don't think there's anything that I could... fault in it. I have watched it a few times. It was a quick storyline. I know some classic films can be a bit long. It was an hour and a half. It was really quick. Oh, I liked
that's
it.
That's what I'm thinking about. What movie did we watch that it was so long? And I'm like, ugh.
The Opera. But yeah. It was the newer one.
Yeah.
Yeah. In our busy lives, a shorter film is much better.
And then the 2005.
2005, again, I've seen it a few times. I wouldn't go out of my way to watch this again. I only watched it, obviously. You chose this one. I would give this a 2. Actually, I'd give it a 2.5. At the time it came out, it wasn't bad. But having rewatched it now, it's pretty terrible. So the 0.5 extra I'm giving it is because at the time it was released, it wasn't a bad film.
Okay, for me, I'm giving the 53 a 4.75.
Oh, you got to one up me.
Of course I do. I just think it was such a great film. I wasn't bored. I was so intrigued going, what is going to happen? And that ending, like, blew me away. It was amazing. And like you said, it didn't feel like it was a long film. I was like, oh, it's over already. Oh, and I like that the ending was just end. And although I do want to talk quickly about Igor and how, like, he was creepy as well. And it's always the Igors that are creepy.
Yeah, it's because they're meant to be... disfigured, ugly, no one wants to talk to them, so then they're loyal to their master. Yeah,
but I thought he was really good. With the 2005, this is the second time I've actually ever seen this film. First time I watched it, I just remember that scene of Jared crying, like the tears coming out.
Yeah, that scene is still memorable to me. It's the first thing I always think of with the 2005 film.
Back then, I did like it. Now, and I'm going to give my rate from now, rewatching it, I'm going to give it a 1.5.
Oh, yeah. If I had to rate it now, I'd probably go 1.5. But at the time it came out, I'd go a 2.5.
The only reason why it's not getting a 1 is because of the soundtrack.
Yeah, I mean, there were some good things. There were some things that were pretty good about it.
All right, big question. What do you think the 50s one got on Rotten Tomatoes?
Okay, first of all, I thought this was the original, so I was hoping maybe it'll be like Frankenstein and rated quite high. I also don't know if many people have seen the classic House of Wax, so I think I'm banking on there being a cult following for this, and I'm going to go, actually, it was the first 3D film as well, so okay, I'm going to go high, 94%.
Oh my god, you were so close.
I get one more shot.
You do, but I'm not telling you. I can't.
You've
got
to tell me higher or lower.
I can't.
Always tell you. Okay, I can't tell you how far. Lower. 93.
Ah, you got it.
Oh, I was always gonna go 92.
You got it.
Yay! I haven't got one in a while. Finally. I'm so glad it got that high. Good. So, I was worried it was going to be one of those films that not many people have seen it, so it was going to be, like, underrated. Oh, yeah. That makes my day. That made my day. All right, let's have a go at the audience score.
Yes.
I feel like it won't be as high. I don't know. I get the vibe maybe 80s, like 88.
Lower.
Oh, now you've really upset me.
Like, lower.
Oh, that's sad. Okay, 73.
Oh my god, you were so close.
Was it 72?
Yep.
I was thinking that in my head, and I'm like, I can't be the same.
Yep.
Damn it. All right. I should have gone with my gut feeling.
That's go okay. With gut feeling on this one. What do you think the Rotten Tomato score was?
The 2005. All right, yeah. This one's hard because for the time it came out, it had some pretty good stuff, like scary-wise. But now, I don't know if many people now have watched it and rated. That's what will bring the score down. So I reckon it's going to be a pretty average mark. 25%.
Far out. You're so close, but higher.
Pressure.
Like, so close.
I bet you it's not as close as before, which was a one. Oh, wait, what did I say? 25.
Mm-hmm. Oh. I'm, like, nervous for you.
I'm so nervous. Do I go 1, 2, 3, 4? 27.
Oh my god, you got it.
No way.
Yeah.
I haven't got one in so long. You know what? I'm okay with that score. I think that's
let's see if we can make it a trifecta.
Oh no, this is pressure. I don't. Okay, take a breath. All right. If it's anything like what I thought, my thought process, you know, was pretty average. My score was about, you know, quarter, but scores now are lower. I'm going to go, like, 13%.
So much higher.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like,
damn. Okay. Yeah. All right. So what did I say? It was 27%, then I went 13. You say so much higher. Better not be freaking higher than the score. Okay. 34?
Nowhere near.
Oh.
42.
Oh, how dare it. Yeah. How could the audience vote that over the, like, original? If the
the audience got 72. The audience got 72 in the original.
Yeah, so, like,
so at least it beat it.
Automator was higher for the original, and then everyone voted it down. Not that it was really bad.
I know.
But then you've got this one where the actual tomato meter is low and then everyone rated it up. They need to get their eyes checked.
They do. Wow, okay. Can't believe you got like two.
I know. I haven't had
any
for
like
6 months. That's like how long it's been. Thanks, man. Oh, I feel like I'm back in it to win it.
Yes. So shall we move on to
Nerdazons Nerdy Notables?
So we both just go, ooh.
What's going on with you? Because I've got a scary story to tell at the end.
Okay, not much with me. I've just had a lot of team calls with my uni this term, which has really taken the nights that I want to just chill out. Kind of sucks. I have been watching House of Dragon each week, purely because I know I do not have binging capacity right now. So I'm like, if I just watch it every week, I know it's 1 hour that I have to put aside. So I watched the last episode of season one before I jumped in this call, and I'm actually about to go and watch the Doctor Who ep because I didn't want to.
So am I. I'm like, can we hurry up so I can watch Doctor Who?
Yeah, same. I'm trying to do this as quick as I can.
Said you weren't up to date with her.
I honestly, I'm not going to go back. I'm only two episodes behind. I don't think I'll need to see it.
Oh, no, you do. Actually, you do.
I think I'll figure it out on the way. I think it'll be all right. Ooh. I think it'll be all right. The only reason I'm watching this story is to see the regeneration. I don't care about anything else of that story.
I'm kind of sad that she's going to go because I genuinely liked her, but the writing was shit.
I liked her first couple of episodes and then it just progressively got worse.
Oh, that was so scary.
There were some good eps. But then I think by halfway through the season, it became very clear that it was no longer an escape from reality.
It was turning into the last season of Game of Thrones.
Yeah.
And, you know, okay, basically, spoilers, that they've stuffed the timeline up and that they've said she's no longer, that she was adopted and that she's not actually a Time Lord.
No, I saw that one. I saw that. Okay. Yeah. I think I watched her season. I just didn't watch. There was a New Year's special.
Oh, that was so. That was.
There was another special just before it. That I think was, it was a Christmas
and
a New Year's.
It was all a dream. No, there was no Christmas.
That's pretty much what I didn't watch, so.
It was all a friggin' dream. That's what it was, and I hate those episodes.
Yeah, sometimes it can work well. Sometimes, no.
Didn't work for that, and it didn't work for the Sherlock Holmes.
I just really hope Yaz has gone out of this next season. She's really irking me.
Please, can you go, Yaz? I'm sorry, but I really don't like you.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's pretty much it for me. So let's hear about yours, and I'm really keen to hear about your story.
I'm going to go see Amsterdam tomorrow.
Oh.
I've heard that. Yeah, it's the new movie with Rami Malek, Robbie Margot.
Oh, yes. That does look all right. Yeah. I have seen that.
It was either that or Halloween Ends.
But we really need to go and see Smile before it's
Yes, off. We do. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. And it was my birthday last week. Please don't. We all went out for dinner. We went out because my mum's the day after me. So we all went out for dinner and we went to a restaurant and I swear it was like 15 people's birthdays.
Oh my God.
The music went really loud and you know that song. Not the happy birthday song, but it's your birthday. And like I was like, oh God.
I did not like the birthday song. Please don't sing at me. Yeah.
And then did you know that it's only Australia that does the hip hip hooray? No other place does hip hip hooray.
I didn't know that. Are you sure?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm just like, what? You've got to do the hip hip hooray. I said to Mum, what do you do when people sing at you? Like, what are you meant to do?
Just sit there and smile awkwardly.
And I took myself out for float therapy, which is amazing. So you basically like float in water that's like full of salt and oh my God, it was amazing.
She did a Stranger Things. In a deprivation.
I did. Tank. I felt like I was 11. I've got one episode left of Rick and Morty. But don't judge me, but I've been really getting into Heartbreak High.
Oh my God, that's so cool. It's like the old one?
No, the remake.
Oh.
Yeah, okay. It's actually not that bad. To me, it's like an Australian version of Sex Education.
Oh, yeah. No, I can see that. I did see the trailer to the new one, so I get that. Yeah.
It was actually really good. It was actually good.
I'll have to have a look. Also, side note, but I've seen the new like poster they've been showing for Amadeus. And like Michael Sheen's face is on it. I'm like, yay!
I don't know anything about this. That like, I will make sure we get to stage door. So if you got your Twilight DVDs, we'll try and get your Twilight DVDs.
I don't have. The Twilight's not what I like. So.
Well, I thought that that's where you were like, oh, no, Michael Sheen.
No, I have liked Michael Sheen since I was in. I realized that because he's someone who just jumps into films and you don't even realize.
Oh, he's amazing.
It's kind of like Tilda Swinton. But anyway, so I remember watching him and having a crush on him back in the seventh grade when I watched, what was it? No, was it seventh grade or year six? Anyway, it was Underworld and he was Lucian.
That's right. I knew it was something sci-fi-ish, not Twilight. Speaking of Tilda Swinton, I'm so annoyed that I missed out on A Thousand Years of Longing.
Seen it yet, but
it is. My friend won an 80-inch TV, so we're gonna go watch it on that.
Nice.
Yeah, and like a $5,000 gaming chair and like a PS, was it PS5 that's out now or PS4?
How did they win this?
On a Instagram competition of like, what's your favorite game in 25 words or less? And then my mate was like, did I win or is this like a scam?
Wow.
No, mate, you won. He won
the
biggest TV ever, a $5,000 gaming chair. The new, is it a PS4 or a PS5 that's PS5. Just five? PS5. And like 8 games, including like the FIFA or something. And like, yeah, I'm just like, oh my God. So I'm going over there and we're going to watch it. On their massive TV.
Nice.
Yeah. So since we're talking about House of Wax and wax and things, I thought I would tell the story of Elma McCurdy. So this is the first time that I've ever heard of this. So it was actually Ange that found this. So
tell me the story. I'm like, nah, let's go with a House of Wax theme.
This is great. Okay.
I love it. It's like I get to listen to the story, but I also get to listen to you figure the story out at the same time.
I know. Elma McCurdy, born 1880 and died 7th of October 1911. He was an American bank and train robber who was killed in a shoot-up with police after robbing a Katy train in Oklahoma in 1911, dubbed the bandit who wouldn't give up. He was the son of 17-year-old Sadie McCurdy, who was unmarried at the time of his birth. The identity of McCurdy's father is unknown. One possibility is Sadie's cousin, Charles Smith McCurdy, who would later use the name Charles Smith as an alias. In order to see the Sadie embarrassment and shame of raising an illegitimate child, her brother George and his wife Helen adopted Elma. After George died of tuberculosis in 1890, Sadie and Helen moved in with Elma to Bangor, Maine. Sadie eventually told her son that she, not Helen, was the mother and that she was unsure of who the biological father was. The news disturbed McCurdy, who grew up resentful and became unruly and rebellious. As a teenager, he began drinking heavily. A habit would continue throughout his life.
Love it. Oh, it's so exciting.
McCurdy decided to incorporate his training with nitroglycerin into his robberies. He often caused problems as he was overzealous and failed to correctly determine the paper amount to use. On September 21, 1911, McCurdy and two other men attempted to rob the Citizens Bank of Chautauqua, Kansas. After spending 2 hours breaking through the bank wall with a hammer, McCurdy placed a nitroglycerin charge around the door of the bank's outer vault. The blast blew the vault door through the bank, destroying an interior, but did not damage the safe inside the vault. McCurdy then tried to blow the door open with nitroglycerin, but the charge failed to ignite. After the lookout men got scared and ran off, McCurdy and his accomplices stole about $150 in coins that were a tray outside the safe and then fled. McCurdy's final robbery took place on October 4, 1911, near Osaka, Oklahoma. McCurdy and two accomplices planned to rob a caddy train after hearing it contained $400,000 in cash that was intended as royalty payment on the Osage Nation. However, McCurdy and the men mistakenly stopped at passenger's train number 29 instead. The men were able to steal only $46 from the mail clerk. Two demijohns of whiskey, a revolver, a coat, and the train conductor's watch. A newspaper account of the robbery later called it one of the smallest in the history of train robbery.
What a troll.
What a troll.
That's so embarrassing.
Let's hope the watch was at least Rolex.
Yeah.
McCurdy was disappointed by the haul and returned to Reverend's Ranch on October 6, where he became drinking the demijohns of whiskey he stole. By the time he was also ill with tuberculosis, which developed after working in mines, and a mild case of pneumonia with trichinus. I don't know these words. Mm-hmm. He stayed up drinking with some of the ranch hands before going to sleep in a hayloft following the morning. Unbeknownst to McCurdy, he had been implicated in the robbery and a $2,000 reward for his capture was issued. In the early morning hours of October 7, a posse of three sheriffs, brothers Bob, a stringer, Frenton, and Dick Wallace, tracked McCurdy to the hay shed using bloodhounds. They surrounded the hay shed and waited for daylight. McCurdy was killed by a single gunshot wound to the chest, which he sustained while lying down.
Now the interesting part.
Post-mortem commercialization. McCurdy's body was taken to the undertaker in Powishka, Oklahoma, where it went unclaimed. Joseph L. Johnson, the owner and the undertaker, embalmed the body with arsenic-based preservative, typically used in the embalming in the era to preserve a body for a long period when no next of kin was known. He then shaved the face, dressed the body in a suit, and stored it in the back of a funeral home. As McCurdy lay unclaimed, Johnson refused to bury or release the body until he was paid for his services. Johnson then decided to exhibit McCurdy to make money. He dressed the corpse in street clothes, placed a rifle in his hand, and then stood him up in the corner of the funeral home. For a nickel, Johnson allowed visitors to see the bandit who wouldn't give up. The bandit became a popular attraction at the funeral home and drew attention of carnival promoters. Johnson received a numerous offer to sell McCurdy's corpse, but refused.
Can I just say, interject, I am loving listening to you read this because you're discovering the story.
I'm like, what?
I'm watching you. We're like, great.
I just like, okay, who wants to see a body? On October 6, 1916, a man calling himself Ava contacted Joseph Johnson, claiming to be Elmer McCurdy's long-lost brother from California. Ava had already contacted the Osage County, Oklahoma sheriff and a local attorney to get permission to take custody of the body and ship it to San Francisco for a proper burial. Following day, Ava arrived at the Johnson funeral home with another man calling himself Wayne. He also claimed to be McCurdy's brother. Johnson released the body to the men, who then put it on a train, assumably to San Francisco. It was instead shipped to Arkansas City, Kansas. The men who claimed to be McCurdy's long-lost brothers were in fact James and Charles Peterson. James Peterson was the owner of the Great Patterson Carnival Show, a traveling carnival. After learning his brother Charles about the popular embalmment bandit exhibit, the two then concocted a scheme to take possession of the body in order to feature it in Patterson's carnival. McCurdy's corpse would be featured in Patterson's traveling circus as the outlaw who would never be captured alive until 1922, when Patterson sold his operation to Louis Sonny. What?
Yeah.
After Louis Sonny died in 1949, the corpse was placed in storage in Los Angeles warehouse. In 1964, Sonny's son Dan lent the corpse to a filmmaker, David F. Friedman. It eventually made a brief appearance in Friedman's 1967 She Freak. In 1968, Dan Sunny sold the body along with other wax figures for $10,000 to Spoonie Sin, the owner of Hollywood Wax Museum. Singh had brought the figures for two Canadian men who exhibit them at the show of the Mount Rushmore. While being exhibited there, the corpse sustained some damage in windstorm. The tips of the ears, along with fingers and toes, were blown off. The men eventually returned the corpse back to Singh, who decided that it looked too gruesome and not lifelike enough to exhibit. Singh then sold it to Ed Leitch, the part owner of the Pike, an amusement zone in Long Beach, California. By 1976, McCurdy's corpse was in the laugh in the dark funhouse exposition at the Pike.
Now the rediscovery.
Okay.
I'm just watching your face. This is better than me reading you the story. You reading it and discovering it yourself is so much more entertaining.
So this is the rediscovery and burial. On December 8, 1976, the production crew of the television show The $6 Million Man was filming scenes for a Carnival Out of Spies episode. During the shoot, a prop man moved what was thought to be a wax mannequin that was hanging from the gallows. When the mannequin's arm broke off, a human bone and muscle tissue were visible.
Yeah.
Police were called and the mummified corpse was taken to the Los Angeles coroner's office. On December 9, Dr. Joseph Choi conducted an autopsy and determined that the body was that of a human male who died of a gunshot wound to the chest. The body was completely petrified, covered in wax, and had been covered with layers of phosphorus paint. It weighed approximately 15 pounds or 23 kilos and was 160 centimeters in height. Some hair was still visible on the sides of the back of the head, while the ears, big toes and fingers were missing. The examination also revealed incisions from the original autopsy and embalming. Tests conducted on the tissue showed that the presence of arsenic, which was a component in the embalming fluid until the 1920s. Tests also revealed tuberculosis in the lungs, which McCurdy had developed while working as a miner, bunions and scars that McCurdy was documented to have. While the bullet that caused the fatal wound was presumably removed during the original autopsy, the bullet jacket was found. It was determined to be a gas check, which were first used in 1905 until 1940. These clues helped investigators pinpoint an era in which the man had been killed. Further clues to the man's identity were found when the mandible was removed for dental analysis. Inside the mouth was a 1924 penny and ticket stubs to the 14W Pike Sideshow and Lewis and Sonny's Museum of Crime. Investigators contacted Dan Sunny, who confirmed that the body was Elmer McCurdy. Dr. Clyde Snow was then called to make a positive identification. Radiographs of the skull and placed them over a photo of McCurdy taken at the time of his death, the process called superimposition. Snow was able to determine that the skull was that of Elmer McCurdy.
Dum, dum, dum.
What? On April 22, 1977, a funeral procession was conducted to transport McCurdy to the Boot Hill section of the Summit View Cemetery in Guthrie, Oklahoma. A graveside service attended by approximately 300 people were conducted, after which McCurdy was buried next to another outlaw, Bill DeLune, to ensure that McCurdy's body would not be stolen. 2 feet of concrete were poured into the casket.
So what did you think?
Wow.
I knew you'd like this one.
I'm sorry. I do apologize for butchering the names. However, I was just reading this and being like, what the actual
F? Your eyes were glued. I was watching you and I'm like, I'm so glad you chose this one.
What? No. I'm glad that you chose it. Wink. Wow.
So good.
Wow.
I'm really glad you liked that one. And it's cool because it was like, obviously because of film was he discovered and being able to put back to rest.
Wow. That was like, fascinating.
Like a horror house that you think just for amusement had a dead body hanging there.
This is why like sideshows and carnies are creepy.
I'm really glad you liked that one. Okay.
Oh, my God. Whoa.
So, my choice, I thought I'd go a little bit different and go with the 1983 Scarface, versus the 1932 version.
Okay, what's your next choice for next fortnight?
Okay, all right. I think that's a good choice. I'm very excited for this. I am doing a listener's choice by our ever strongest supporter, MJ Macca Jr. Their suggestion was to do The Thing 1982 versus The Thing 2011.
Ooh, so if you want to follow us at Nerdazons on Facebook and Instagram, if you have a suggestion, just like Macca Jr., you can send us an email at nerdazons@outlook.com. You can listen to us on Spotify, iHeartRadio, Apple Podcasts, and wherever you get your good podcasts. Until then, stay nerdy!